How low can you go?
Let's get high. 3, 2, 1.
Off the cuff, where the talk transforms. Off the cuff, yeah, we're speaking free.
Welcome to another Off the Cuff. Along with Ed, I'm Keith. We're so glad to have you with us. Ed, Off the Cuff has kind of been an inspiration in my life.
I understand this. You know what? when we first came up with this idea, and you asked me, I said, "Of course," because I say yes to everything you asked me to do. Whether it's
I have
RV
asked you
TV,
to do a lot too.
Yeah, right. RVTV, Friday Night Football. It's all good.
Sound
I love
off.
Being with you. Whatever it takes, I'm there. But this has been a lot of fun, and it's kind of taken off for us. But your inspiration is what?
My inspiration. I mean, we announced this week that. That our radio show that Andy and I do, the Murph and Andy radio show, which is on KXNO, mm-hmm. that at the end of June we're going to stop doing it after more than 15 years. And it's been a great run, and people have been so nice to us. The outpouring of in some cases, really personal emotions for people has been really gratifying, you know, because... We knew that people listened, and we knew it was growing, and we know what the numbers are and the downloads are. What I didn't have a good feel for is just how many people like made it a part of their day, like an appointment, or you know, the truck drivers or the delivery drivers or people working outside. And that's the best kind of feeling. It doesn't change my thought that suddenly I think it's important, like a right. first responder or school teacher or nurse or something like that. But it's very nice to know that we help people pass the time and maybe entertain some people along the way. But the way this ties into Off the Cuff is one of the things I realized is like this, people may not know this, but this literally is off the cuff. Like we right. don't have a script. We don't have a rundown.
No.
It is truly
off the
cuff.
And it's probably obvious to many people that we don't.
Yeah, they're like,
oh, really?
You didn't really have to tell us that. I've seen it before. And I believe you.
There's no teleprompter? Really?
Huh. Really? I can't. Such a neatly and tightly scripted show. I'm surprised. You usually bring something up and then don't mention it for the next 10 minutes. But... you fill in on the Murph and Andy show, and Andy's gone.
Right.
I've had you on many times. Another, hey, Ed, would you mind? Sure.
And I love it. It's so much fun to do. But talk about script. You're not reading from a script. But when I first started doing it, I mean, I came in and here's Murph, and there's a bullet point page here in front of me, couple pages
mm-hmm.
of typed out. Whomever your producer was, you know, either Andrew or Lucas.
Yeah.
Had to get everything printed.
Right.
Put it out.
We still do that.
2024 era. But I really appreciate it because I know you spent a lot of hours even before the show to put this all together. And that's a link to making it such a successful show. But maybe just a side link. But you and Andy were the main characters.
Well, it's just...
Are the main characters for a while.
That's the way that I'm comfortable doing it, and all the audio requests I would have, and just a format, and these show staples that we would do each day, like Trending Iowa, or Throwdowns, or Guess Who's Birthday, more segment that mm-hmm. Andy does. So we would put all that together, but it takes a couple hours in the morning, and then you also have to be prepared for, oh, there's breaking news or something happened and everybody's talking about it, and then you just have to blow the lineup up, forget about that, and go in a completely different direction, which we do sometimes. But I think a lot of people picture the radio show being similar to what Andy's experience was when he was producing a radio show in St. Louis. The local sportscasters that came in, they showed up and they're just like, all right, what do we have today, Andrew?
Right.
And he would tell them who the guests are.
He
and
really
stuff,
was a producer.
Right. And they just showed up.
In that era. Your producer is the guy that's running the board
right.
inside of a soundproof area, usually. I mean, although Andrew and Lucas, you know, super involved in your program every single day. I love that as well. But, yeah, a producer is the guy that's just making sure levels are right and you get calls. And then they'll, you know, take care of all the people that are calling in to give it, you know, give you that mm-hmm. that personal touch, too. But and to set you guys up for it. Different world, a different producer term.
Exactly. So it is, it's not just the 2 hours on the air or the time it takes to get to the radio station. I start working about 10 in the morning. The good part of it is the radio show, besides the synergy of the, you know, the radio station, the TV station, feeling like this would be good for both sides, which it is, it made me much better at my job here, because by noon, I had, you know, chatted with the producers here. I usually sent something to Mark Freund and John Sears about the day ahead. I had a good idea what people were talking about, what they were interested in, all of that. So it's made me better here. But when we talked about doing off the cuff, it's like, I want to do something opposite of what the radio show is, and that's no script, no plan, off the cuff.
And this is much more attuned to my life.
Yeah, because weather, you don't have a script.
Right. You don't have a script. You don't ever write anything out. We build all of our own maps, and then we watch when we're on the air to tell the weather story, tell the story of the day, and just rearrange your maps to do that, or build new maps, whatever. But there's no script. And I joke, I say, you know, why weather people screw up, we can't read. But we don't have the teleprompter. But this is a fun format.
It's I enjoy it. And the skill that you have and the other meteorologists have to not have a script or a teleprompter, especially when you're on the air, as you've been many times over the past month, for hours at a time, that's a true talent. And one of the things I'm thankful for, and this goes to my age and how small my first station was where I worked in Valdosta, Georgia, we didn't have a teleprompter.
What?
We didn't have a teleprompter. But that ended up being one of the blessings.
You didn't even have one of the paper ones that was like on a treadmill?
No, we didn't. So
did you start before Bachman?
Yeah. Did you start before color television? So you had to read, you know, you'd read your scripts up and down, and you would have to do some of that and just look down. And that ended up being a good thing for me, because over the years, I've seen many people who have only used a teleprompter, and then something happens to the prompter, and they're just kind of a little bit lost and deer in the headlights. But almost anything is like what you've been trained to do or what you're used to. So I think that helped me, and that I can fall back on, I don't have a teleprompter, I know how to do this. My problem now is we no longer have papers.
Right.
We have those tablets.
I
forget to advance the script sometimes.
It's recnology. That's what I call it, recnology. Yeah. Because I would just as soon have the paper scripts in my hand. I know
Me
that's
too.
Old school.
Me too.
But also, if there's breaking news, you can take notes. And you actually use a pen.
Yeah.
It's a little thing you write with, and paper to write down those things so you don't forget them. It's harder to do when you're trying to, you know, thumb type out something on a pad.
You prefer holding a book, or have you switched over to like tablets? Because I like to hold a book.
I like to hold a book. It was hard to get rid of newspapers. We until recently just got rid of. We still get the Sunday edition, but I enjoyed holding the paper.
Same.
I like to see it. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I used to be a big part of my childhood, propping that paper up against the milk or the cereal box and reading the sports section. And my parents would encourage me read another section too, but. I didn't always do that. So we're done with the radio show at the end of June. I've had so many people ask me, if we're retiring. We're not. Yeah. I mean, first of all, I have this job, which is full time, and Andy and I we'll do something together again. We've already had a couple of people that are like, hey, would you like to do a podcast here? We'll do something, but we're not. What we're not going to do is 5 days a week, 2 hours a day in a building. We're not going to go work at another radio station. There's nothing about that. We want to take a step back.
I know the answer to this question, but many people ask me. In fact, other radio people who didn't maybe want to ask you guys, did they kick them out? Did they just say, hey, we can't afford them anymore?
No, they were great. Yeah. They offered us 3 more years. That's what kind of was, we had been talking about this time to time. But it's hard sometimes to take that step.
Right.
But then when they were talking to us about a new 3-year agreement, and this started in mid-May, because our contract was up at the end of May, and we were just like, ooh, it's time to do less.
And, well, in 6 days. I mean, you're taking one of your weekend days, which is a Friday to Saturday because of doing sound off on Sundays, but that's a day where you really don't get a whole day off.
Right.
And you work at those extra hours. I'm telling you, that's what really got me, is I knew what time you get up and get this stuff going.
Yeah.
And then you're still here till 10:30, 11 o'clock at night, at least, you know, and you're the most prolific social media outlet. I get so much information from you, not just from sports, but also just to other genres. And now I understand you're a vampire. you don't sleep overnight.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I know if there's one, when I'm up late, I know there's one person I can reach. It's you or your wife, Angela.
We're
you're both night owls.
Yeah.
You're both, I know not to try to reach you at 9 a.m.
No, you know, probably not going to happen.
Yeah, not for that. But no, it's been great. I know we'll have you in before the end of the radio run.
Good.
People have been so nice, and Andy and I will continue to be together on Sound Off. We'll do something again sometime, but it's been awesome. And thank you to all people out there who have sent well wishes and all that. I appreciate
it. And I'm not, you know, just placating here. I love you to death as a friend, but this is the best 2 hours of radio I've ever heard. And I don't care what
thank
genre.
You.
It's been so much. I was in radio years ago, and I loved radio, but this made me fall in love with it again, because it wasn't, like you said, it wasn't just off-topic, silly stuff all the time, but it also wasn't just all sports, you know, which so many sports shows obviously are. This is the more that I loved, and it was so much fun to watch. And I got to think that so many people driving, if they were in their cars and heard this, it was like, what? What am I going to do now from 1 to 3?
The management at KXNO, who have been great to us, they asked us to not say anything.
Sure.
Which we're going to honor that. They've been good to us. But it was hard, because we've had a few people be like, hey, how come you didn't say anything? Well, give your word. You need to keep that. But no, it's been a good run. And interestingly, about what you said, Ed, I think the topic that I've heard the most in somebody saying like this meant something to me was the COVID era, which was interesting because there were no sports.
Right.
So we had 2 hours a day, but no sports. You know, the governor would come on and we'd give the totals and we'd talk about other things and we'd try to, it became a whole different thing. But it's been interesting to me that period of time with no sports was kind of some people's most impressionable era.
I'm not trying to measure you up to Caitlin Clark. I mean, she has her own effect.
Yeah,
but
please
this
don't.
This was the Murph and Andy effect in this micro scale where people were at home so much, you had to listen to that. It's good stuff. Thank you for all the years.
Well, thanks for giving me this outlet with no script.
Woo, no script, everybody.
This is way easier.
Let's go build some maps.
Let's call that a wrap for this off the cuff. That's 71, I think. But is that right, Doug? Yeah. 71?
Well, 71. This one was longer than
71.
Most. This could be 71 and 72.
Hey, Doug, could you come out here for a second? Because somebody asked me, who's this guy you're yelling to off camera? Doug, can you just come stand in the middle? This is Doug Sawyer. He is the person behind the scenes for Off the Cuff, pressing the buttons, adding photos.
T3.
Yeah.
He's the man. Love it. Thanks
yeah,
for,
is there anything you'd like to say?
I'd like to thank my mom, my dad, my friend Keith, and my friend Ed.
Okay, that was uncomfortably close.
Yeah.
That's a wrap, Ed.
Wrap.
No script, no plan, just go with the flow where the topics land. Well, nobody knows, it's a laughter, it's stories we adore with Keith and Ed. You'll always want more, so bring your thoughts and bring your cheer. We're breaking molds with every gear in the show. We're family setting the pace. Off the cuff, where the vibes are right, with Keith and Ed lining up your night. Every moment's a surprise, wait and see. Off the cuff, where the vibes are right, Keith and Ed lining up your night. Every moment's a surprise, wait and see. To